The following program is presented by the HTM Podcast Network.
Good afternoon, everybody. This is Robin Nelson with another edition of Wrestle Popcast. And my guest for today is Missa Kate. How's it going?
Good, how are you?
Pretty good. Tell us a little bit about your match last night.
Last night was intense. So right now at Kaiju, I'm captured by the following in Jesus Christ. So last night, it was kind of a mixture of, if I won the match, I'm set free now. I get my freedom. But at the same time, it was to determine the number one seed in a tournament that Kaiju is going to be having in September for a Kaiju Cup, the Women's Kaiju Cup. There's a lot of people in there. You got Elena Black, your Karen Noya, you had Vanessa Zor, Sierra, who ended up winning it, and Jordan Grace and myself. So yeah, there's a bunch of lot going on, but I got it to the final two, and then, yeah, I lost, but...
Hey, that's all right. At least you were in there. There was a lot of great talent you just said about in the ring. I mean, Jordan Ann Grace, she's a beast.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, I know. I felt her. She's all in everything that everybody says, so she hits hard.
So when you got in the ring with her, what was it like to get in the ring with her? Were you, like, a little nervous? Did you have goosebumps, or what were you thinking?
I know who she is, obviously. But I'm weird. I never really get, I guess, quote unquote, starstruck or anything like that.
Uh-huh.
I was nervous in the sense that she's, like how you said, she's a beast. So I was like, all right, this is going to hurt. I'm just going to take it and just keep going. I just got to keep coming back with it. So, I mean, I was ready for it. I could take a beating.
Hey, that's the purpose of a pro wrestler. You get beat and then you beat somebody else up.
That's right. Hey, I'm from Chicago. We're the underdogs, so I'm used to it.
So, where did they come up with the nickname, the Chicago Sweetheart?
So, actually, it's kind of funny. I did, when I first started wrestling, you always ask me for, like, monikers, or what's your moniker, what's your nickname, what's this? I always wanted something to be Chicago. So, I was like, I'm not exactly, always like, contrast of nicknames and whatever to whoever the character is. I'm not exactly... I'm not exactly girly. Usually when you think of sweetheart, you think of like the girly girl or girl next door, or however you want to perceive it. So I'm kind of not. So I was like, Chicago Sweetheart, that's just me.
And I like that. It fits you perfectly as well.
Thank you.
Yeah, so did you grow up in the Chicago area?
Yeah, born and raised.
All right. So what was it like growing up in Chicago and also growing up, were you like a huge wrestling fan?
Yeah. So growing up in Chicago, it's fun. I know there's a lot of bad publicity and like news and all this stuff going on. I'm sure you hear all the time like, oh, someone got hurt again in Chicago. Someone got killed here. Yeah, there's good and bad areas everywhere. But I tell everybody like we're just such a melting pot of people like, everyone here is, like, very family-oriented. It's a very fun city. Unfortunately, it's just that, like, the bad stuff gets shown more than the good stuff that goes on here. But, yeah, it was definitely fun. I can't imagine growing up anywhere else. I wouldn't want to, honestly. People ask me all the time, are you ever going to move out of Chicago or out of Chicago area? And I'm just like, no. Like, this is my home. Like, I can't. I've been to Florida. I've been to California. I'm just like, ugh. Like, no, I'm staying in Chicago. But yeah, so growing up in Chicago was fun. As far as wrestling, the first time I got introduced to wrestling, I was very young. And funny enough, the first match I ever saw was John Cena against Kurt Angle, which was John Cena's debut in Chicago, if you know. I just think it's funny. It's just like Chicago is always like linked in somewhere, you know? And I was watching it with my grandpa, and he unfortunately went blind due to diabetes, so he couldn't see what was going on, but he heard like the commentary and all stuff. He's like, he has a thick accent. He was from Europe. So he's like, what are you watching? No, this is no good. Because he used to watch back in the day, Gorgeous George and all them. And he would get really amped up. And he's telling me, he's like, oh no, you don't watch that. You watch that, you're going to get a hole in stomach and die, like pretty much saying I have an ulcer. And at the time, I'm like six. I'm like, well, I don't want to die, so I'm just not going to watch this anymore. But yeah, that was the first time I got introduced to wrestling. I stopped watching it, and then after that, the next match that I saw was the Edge versus Matt Hardy ladder match with Lita. And it was a match where whoever won the contract stayed on Raw, and then the loser went to SmackDown. And I don't know what it was. Like, Lita's my girl. She's the reason why I'm doing this. Ever since I saw her, I was like, that's it. I want to be a wrestler. Like, I was hooked. And, yeah, so ever since then, I think I was like, I don't know when that was. That was a while ago. It was like nine. But, yeah, so, I mean, I've been hooked ever since. So, yeah, probably... If my grandpa didn't tell me I was going to die from watching it, I probably would have watched it as long like as I that first match. But, yeah, I've been a fan forever. I love it. There's nothing like it.
So, like you said, Lita's the one that really influenced you to pursue your goals of professional wrestling and training as well. And another question, when you started training and getting into wrestling, did your grandfather get a chance to, witness this?
So, no, unfortunately, he passed before I got into high school, I believe. And so, yeah, it was before I got into high school. It was around 6th, 7th grade, which he would not like, especially because I'm his granddaughter. They call me Grandpa's Angel all the time. My mom's the youngest of four.
Okay.
So I was the first grandchild on his side, in the family. So I was, like, babied and spoiled by him. So he would probably not be happy. Like, right now he's probably looking down like, what are you doing with yourself? But... I would still do it anyway, because it's just like I like it, I'm going to do what I want to do sort of thing.
That's pretty good as well. Was your mom and family very supportive as well when you decided to get into the ring?
So, they're supportive more so now. I mean, they were never not supportive. More so my mom, because I've had like a couple injuries in the past from other sports, and so I'm already she's already worried about me already being banged up. And then on top of that, she knows the physicality of the sport, and, like, she only knows stuff that you look up. So, obviously, when you look up something about wrestling, it's always going to be the worst possible injury or head injury or whatever it is, the worst possible story. So she was worried about all of that, and then, of course, I'm her daughter. So she's like, I don't want watching you get beat up. I don't want you getting hurt. I don't want this to be something... you get hurt now, and it affects you more in the long run sort of thing. So she's going to be a mom about it. But, yeah, she was there for my first match. My stepdad was there for my first match. I had family and friends. But, yeah, I have a good little support group. So every match, though, my mom's like, oh, you did good. So are you quitting? It's going to be the same line every time. She's like, so when are you going to be done with this? Are you done now? I'm like, Mom, I just got over a year doing this. So, but yeah, it's just a mom thing. I get it. I'm her kid. I mean, if I had a kid, I'd probably feel the same way. I mean, I'm like that watching my friends, even my friend that wrestle, I'm like, oh, like you're hurting yourself, why? But then I'll go in there and get hit harder. So it's kind of like, I can't really say anything.
Yeah. Hey, I feel you. I have friends in the business as well, wrestlers too, and I think the same thing as well. And this is your first year anniversary working matches as well.
Yeah, it was the 19th of May, I think it was.
I believe it was May 19th. I did look that up, yes.
Yeah. So it's funny, that day, too, I posted on my social media, Vanessa Azor, she was actually my second match ever after Shotzi. And her date is actually the same day as mine when she started wrestling matches, too. It was her 2 year, my 1 year. So I was like, oh, it's like a weird, cute little thing, I guess, that we're wrestling each other on our anniversary. But, yeah, that was fun.
Speaking of Vanessa Azor, what's it like to get in a ring with her? And do you guys have, like, great chemistry?
Oh, my God, yeah. I call her my wrestling wife. Anytime her and I have gotten in the ring, the first time her and I got in the ring, it was just, like how you said, it's chemistry. It's just, there's some people that you feel it or you don't. Sometimes it feels kind of rigid or whatever. Her and I, we honestly beat the hell out of each other. it'll still be like a fun time. Like, we just, it's just, I don't know, you can't, it's one of those things you can't really put a finger on, but we, in the day that we had the match recently on our anniversaries, we each talk to each other, we each push each other in different ways, so we always like working each other.
So when you guys work with each other, each time, do you guys learn from each other and improve as well?
Oh, I would say so, definitely. So I'm more, I feel like I'm more, I love her, character, she's there. Like, I'm just like, every time I see her, I'm just like, yeah, like, she gets me behind her, which I wish I could be more like her in that sense. And I feel like I'm more of, I guess, like, the technical side, as far as, like, moveset. So she, and that's the conversation that we had, she's like, oh, you always push me with moves. I'm like, well, you always push me to bring out this character and, like, actually be like, oh, wrestling's fun. Like, we can have fun in the ring, you know? It doesn't all have to be about the moves and stuff. So, yeah, we, like I said, we have the chemistry and we just bounce off of each other like that, I guess.
Yeah, and speaking of your first match, you got in a ring with another beast as well, and she's pretty good. And what was it like? What was it like to get in with Shotzi Blackheart?
I can't say it enough. I'm so lucky that she was my first match. Looking back at it now, I feel so bad because I was just so freaking nervous, and she just was chill the entire time. Anything I needed, anytime, whatever I was feeling any kind of way, she just brought me down. It was this weird thing, and she took care of me, and it was fun. She hits hard for a freaking like 10-pound girl, but she hits hard. But yeah, she was fun. I'd love to, now that I am more experienced, and I won't be as nervous. I'm always nervous, obviously. I feel like you should be a good nervous when you go into the ring, but yeah, I'd love to have a rematch with her one day. If you're listening, Shotzi. But yeah, that was awesome. Yeah, I can't say enough good stuff about her.
Yeah, she's good. I've seen her a lot in a lot of matches as well. And then another great wrestler you got in a ring in too, I know she probably gave you the fight for your life as well, and you probably learned a lot from her, was Thunder Rosa.
Yeah. I learned, yeah. She did. She, it's hard to explain. You just kind of pick up on stuff while you're in the ring. You're like, okay, so I got to do this and that's that. But yeah, she definitely taught me a lot. Just me and her just being in there. Yeah, she beat my, like, she and that one, they train in Mexico, they train you to hit hard, and that's not a joke. And they like getting hit hard back. I didn't know that at the time. So I'm just like, you know, just trying to work my match to see the best that I could, and I'm just like, this girl's just beating the shit out of me. Like, what do I do? But, yeah, so that match I learned, like, it's okay to hit back and hit harder back, so. But yeah, she's a sweetheart, too. But yeah, just don't, I would say don't mess with her.
Shoot, I'm not a wrestler and I wouldn't mess with her.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, speaking, since you worked with Thunder Rosa and Vanessa Azor as well, since you're luchador wrestlers, what was your experience like over at Lucha Libre Total Chicago?
So that was actually, I've done three lucha shows now, two of which were at LLT, the other one was at Gali. It's different. The fans are different. The matches are just, everything is completely, you've got to change a lot of stuff when you're in there. So they do like more of the, you know, it's lucha, so they like the high flying and the flashy stuff. They don't really care for the technical so much. They like the character. So you just need to learn. And that's why I like going to different places like that, like Lucha Libre shows, because you learn to fit with the crowd, and you, as you're in there, you kind of learn to adjust to the crowd. So yeah, it's fun. It's definitely fun. The crowd, I like the crowd more sometimes at Lucha shows because they're just more into it if you get into it. And it kind of pushes you to get more into the match too. So that was definitely fun. I like working lucha shows.
So I know you more, you probably trained more of the technical aspect of, you know, your moves and positions as well. So have you picked up any like lucha moves as well, since you've gotten some experience in the ring with luchas?
definitely. My trainer now, so I first started training at CSW with Steve Boz. They're very old school, hard hitting, somewhat technical, I'd say, but more so very old school. Now where I am, I'm at freelance training, or freelance, and you have Bryce Benjamin, Jesus Bryce, he's like known to so many different things. He trains me now, and he teaches a lot of lucha stuff, because he's done a lot of lucha. So it's fun, because it's pushing me out of my element. I want to learn how to do some high flying stuff, but at the same time, I'm like, my body doesn't want to do it. So it's fun learning it, because I'm like, okay, so it's just different, and I like it. I mean, technical, like you said, it's just more, my body just flows with it more. So, but yeah, like, if I can learn a little bit of everything, because I feel like everybody should be well-rounded in everything, that would be awesome. So I have no problem learning lucha, technical, whatever.
That's pretty good as well. Also, do you think in-ring psychology is just as important as well in matches?
Say it one more time.
In-ring psychology?
Mm-hmm. So, the in-ring psychology, yeah. Are you saying as far as lucha shows?
Or yeah, I mean, of all the shows you wrestled at, lucha, wrestling, does that also be is a big impact as well when you're performing a good match and story?
Oh, yeah, definitely. So, there's definitely going to be more, like I was kind of saying before, you got to adjust to the crowd.
Mm-hmm.
Lucha's more, they don't really care as much as the story, as much as they just really want flashy moves, and they want you to tend to them and kind of, you're a heel, they want you to like talk crap to them. If you're a good guy, they want to cheer for you. You have other places I was at Berwyn Championship Wrestling, where they're similar. I don't know if you heard of this, but in Japan, I guess, where they literally just sit and watch and like almost like study the match. So during the match, they're not necessarily cheering or anything, so it's hard to get that feedback when you're in there, because you're like, do you like this? Do you not like this? Like, we're trying to figure it out. And they don't, until you give them some kind of attention or give them that option, be like, oh, yeah, are you ready? You know, just like the typical baby face thing. Like,
yeah.
So they cheer for you. Or if you're a heel, you're like, oh, screw you. And they're like, boo. But it's like a very short, oh, yeah, clap, 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 silent again. Or boo, and then silent again. So, yeah, there's definitely different crowds. You have crowds that just want a story. Like, I feel like at CSW, they like more of the stories, like how Brubaker in my matches. Because you have those crowds that want to get emotionally invested in stuff. So, yeah, it's definitely different everywhere you go. And it's fun because I like being challenged like that. So, I love it.
What's the locker room like working over at Brubaker Women's Wrestling?
At Berwyn, most locker rooms, you're mixed with the guys.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, so, I mean, for that show, who was it? Me, Vanessa, Moxie Molly, and Blair Onyx. Everyone's chill. The guys always, everyone's always, like, tends to their own, whoever's in their match sort of thing. But, yeah, there's not, at like last night at Kaiju, there was actually like a little girl, like not a little girl's room, but like a girl's locker room, sort of. We had our own room, mm-hmm. because there was a bunch of us. If there's not usually a lot of girls, then we just interact with the guys.
Yeah.
I've never, though, been in a locker room that, I want to say disrespected the girls or anything like that.
Yeah.
I've been in locker rooms where it's a lot of tension or something like that, but never. Or at least I felt never disrespectful to the women or the female talent.
Okay, now let's talk about CSW. You're their first ever CSW champion, being a woman wrestler, and you had that brutal match with the Filthy King Brubaker. Tell us about that.
Yep, that was intense. So pretty much the storyline went. I had a triple threat against Savannah Stone and Heather Reckless months ago. And I don't know if he was looking for a manager or what. Whatever the case was, he interfered in my match. I think I was
about 20 minutes. He came in, kind of threw me off, and cheap-shotted me with the clothesline. No explanation. Continuing on, he had a match with Hades, ladder match for his belt now. And he's just kind of beating up Hades and just to help out Hades and kind of get him back a little bit for his cheap shot. I gave him a little taste of his own medicine. I came in with a chair and I shot him in the back. From there, we had this match now recently, and he put his title on the line, or the general manager made it a title match just because of everything that's happened. So, for bigger working with him, I've known him since I started training. He's a cool guy. It was fun working him. That was the only match that I've had so far that I had so much emotion invested in it. Like, I had my stepdad on the side there with my mom. For this match, because obviously it's a title match, I actually had a lot of family and friends there. But I thought that's pretty good at keeping it cool. He was just like, after the match, though, he was just like, I wanted to beat the hell out of Brubaker. And he was like, pissed. So I was like, good, we did our job. But I was like, please don't, though, but good, I'm glad you feel that way. But yeah, that was fun. Brubaker's fun to wrestle. I do it a million times. He pushed me in a lot of ways, especially, like I said, it was the first emotionally invested match that I've been in. So that was different. Yeah, it was intense. He cheated. But whatever. So now I'm suspended because I hit the general manager in the face. So I'm not going to be there for the next show, but the show following, I'll be there, and hopefully I'll get back at him. And I'm going to be Missa Two Belts.
Oh, yeah, that'd be cool to see you with two belts. So when you won that CSW title from him, how huge was the pop from the audience?
That was pretty big. There's a video on YouTube. I have to upload it to my own channel. But, it's hard when you're in the ring sometimes to really register or hear how big the crowd's reaction is. But when you actually hear it in the ring, they're like, okay, this is a big reaction. So you could see everybody's cheering. Like, I watched the footage back and everyone's cheering, and there was a huge pop. Obviously got taken away right after because he slipped knuckles in my tights, trying to say that the reason I won is because I hit him with the knuckles. So then I obviously had the title taken from me and given back to him. But yeah, there was a loud response. Like I said, it was a very emotional match. and I think, as far as I know, that was the first intergender championship match. Yes, I could be wrong, but I think that was the first intergender championship match that they've had, especially at that, I can't think of the word right now, but at that popularity? No, that's not the right word. But the point where a lot of people knew about it, and there was a huge crowd there for it, so.
Hey, that's good. And then you were in, you also worked with another interesting individual in the ring as well, Elena Black. Tell me a little bit about her.
She, that's my little scream queen. I trained with her also at Freelance. I don't know. She's, like I said, she's my little scream queen. She's like, I love her to death. But we also beat the hell out of each other. She's good. Her freaking character is amazing. She is, especially now, last night, she blew me away. You could tell she was just on it. She was in her character fully, and I'm just like, yeah. But I can't cheer for you right now because you're a bad guy. But inside, I was like, yeah, girl, like, kill him. She was yelling in kids' faces. She's awesome. She's definitely going to be known in the Midwest, I think. She is already, but she's, yeah, my little scream queen.
I like how you say the little scream queen. That's cute.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's funny. You're like, yeah, that's my little scream queen. I love her and hate her, but we love to beat the crap out of each other, like how me and Brubaker are.
Yep, pretty much. Like sisters, you know?
Yeah. When you're not in the ring, you go to college as well, and you're studying rehab science, and you're working on your bachelor's in physical therapy. What got you interested into physical therapy?
So I always say I'm blessed. A lot of people in life, they don't really have a dream in general, and I have this blessing of being or wanting to have having two dreams. I tore both of my ACLs in high school at the same time at separate times.
Ouch.
And just going through the process of physical therapy, seeing a physical therapist and whatnot, I was just like, not to shit on anybody, but in the physical therapy kind of world, there's a lot of people that I notice, they don't have a lot of personality. And when you're going to that and you're in pain and you're doing these exercises and whatnot, you want to be there. You want to be engaged. Just like a match, right? You're there and you want to be engaged in it. So you don't want to just sit there and be bored and be like, oh, I don't want to come back here. I was so fortunate to where my physical therapist, he had the loudest personality in the room. If it wasn't for him, I probably would have been like, screw this. I'm just sitting at home and doing my own rehab at home. So kind of seeing that and seeing the lack of personality, I was just like, I could do this. And I want to help people. The human anatomy always interested me. I love learning like how it works, because I feel like just the human body is just incredible in general. And so just take all that and I was just like, yeah, I want to be a physical therapist too. So I got my associate's at a community college. Right now I'm going to UIC Chicago to get my bachelor's in rehab sciences, and then I have to continue on until I get my doctorate in physical therapy, because now you need a doctorate, or before you needed a master's. But I'm going to be in school for a while, and plus this way I'm like, oh, when I retire from wrestling, now I could help out the wrestlers and, you know, the physical therapy, because there's going to be a couple, probably including myself.
That's pretty good. You learning that that will help you out in the wrestling business as well. You know, knowing your body and what your body can do, and that will help you out a lot. So that's pretty good. You are studying that, and like you said, helping the other wrestlers as well.
Yeah, definitely.
Also, besides wrestling and studying at college, what do you enjoy for fun?
So for fun, I tell everybody all the time, I'm a pretty boring 23-year-old. I love wrestling, school. I want to get my degree, obviously. Working, I have my family. I have some friends that I go out with sometimes, but I have to stay busy. And I always in the mindset of, depending on what I'm doing, if I'm not being proactive, then it's kind of like, what am I doing? So I've never really been into the partying scene. I've never really been into, oh, let's just go sit around and hang out and do nothing. Like, physically, I can't do that. I'm too much of a busybody. Even when I was little, my mom, that's why I was in so many sports. She's like, all right, like, you need to be in something. I can't just, you can't be here because you're just running around the house. Like, you need to be in sports. So I've always been like that. I always try to stay active. If it's like right now, I'm on I think it's 16 in softball league. It started last night, so I missed it because of the match. But I try to stay active. I love being outside. Everyone makes fun of me at training and stuff because I never see like movies or TV shows. They're always talking about all these movies and TV shows. I'm like, yeah, never seen that. Nope, never seen that. I don't know what you're talking about, because I'm always out and I like being active outside. So it's kind of like a joke in my where I train, but I'm like, yeah, they're all asses. Just teasing me all the time about it. But yeah, anything active.
Hey, that's pretty good. I've been to Chicago lots of times to see some, indie promotions up there as well, like AAW and all that. And I've noticed how wrestling fans in Chicago are just straight diehard wrestling fans. They'll either give you a thumbs up or a thumbs down. What's it like what's it like to, wrestle in Chicago with hardcore fans there?
I feel like it's honestly the best place to work and wrestle because they're not going to bullshit you. They're going to tell you how they feel. If you, I don't, are we allowed to swear?
Yeah, go ahead. This is my show, damn it, but go ahead.
Sorry, but if you fucked up, they're going to say you fucked up and you're going to hear it all night. And, but the thing is, they'll let you know, they'll still get behind you unless you continue to mess up or if you, just have like a really crappy match, which I mean, I feel like that's rare because Chicago, and it's funny, I was just talking to Bryce about this yesterday. Chicago is like the main place, in our opinion, for wrestling. Like the Midwest is the main place for wrestling. Now I know Texas is getting big. I feel like there's a couple shows popping up in California, kind of New Jersey, but Chicago has always been like the heart and soul of professional wrestling, especially indie wrestling. So yeah, I feel like it's the best place to wrestle. They're not going to lie to you. They're going to tell you if they love you or hate you. They just back you up. They just want, they're there. They want to support you. They want to be entertained, just all these things. And like how I said, you have so many different options. I haven't traveled out. All the shows that I've done, I think the furthest one that I did was, I think the furthest one I did was maybe in Wisconsin.
Okay.
So, but even there, like, no, I don't even think I went to Wisconsin. Yes, I've only been in Chicago. So all these shows that I've only been in Chicago, I told you as far as like the psychology or how the crowd is, you still get all these different options and all these different crowds, and you still learn from it. And it's just in one place, in one city. So, yeah, it's just, I don't know, it's just a place for wrestling, I feel like.
Oh, I think so, too. I've witnessed it, too. You know, indies, and, you know, I went to All In there last year as well, and that was really...
Okay.
That was really huge, too. Speaking of Midwest wrestling, I enjoy Midwest wrestling as well. Do you see yourself going out, like, wrestling over in Indiana and Ohio? They've got some great promotions out there, and their fans are just as crazy as the Chicago fans.
Yeah, I've heard. Definitely. Yeah, I'm open to go anywhere right now. I mean, in the summer, I have two shows. Two or three shows that are in Wisconsin, that's why I'm confused. They're coming up. I haven't been there yet, but they're coming up. So yeah, I have a couple shows coming up in Wisconsin. In the summertime is like the time for me to travel because of school. During school, I just have to stay local. But yeah, I'm always open to going anywhere. I'm open to travel anywhere, almost anywhere. But how we were just talking about, like, the Midwest is the place for indie wrestling, so I'm very fortunate that I really don't have to travel that much. And I kind of like that. just because, I mean, planes freak me out, but if I gotta go, I gotta go. I'd rather do a plane ride than drive for 16 hours somewhere. But yeah, I'm always open to traveling out, learning different crowds, all that stuff, meeting new people, always open.
So, where do you see yourself in 2019 and then beginning in 2020?
Ooh, good question. I'm not very good at looking into the future, as bad as that sounds. Uh-huh. I'm kind of a go-with-the-flow kind of person.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I've never really sat down and really looked at it, but there's definitely promotions that I'm like, oh, I want to at least have a match here. Or there's people that I'm like, oh, I want to work them or something like that. I have those goals. 2020, I guess I just want to increase my the shows that I'm at. Every month now, I look at my calendar and I'm like, wow, like I have more shows than I did last month, which is awesome. Yeah, I just hope that continues to grow. And yeah, I mean, I love it. I love the sport. I'm in it for the sport. So wherever it takes me, I'll be happy with.
So where can everybody find you on social media if they want to know what Missa Kate's going to do next?
Yeah, so I'm mostly active on Instagram. I try to do the best I can with my Facebook page because I know that's a very interactive Facebook's a very interactive social media platform for wrestling. Twitter, I don't know what it is with Twitter. Me and Twitter do not get along. I can't stick with it. I can't tell you what I'm doing every 2 seconds, but everything that I have is Missa Kate 11. So MissaKate, and then the number 11. Mostly on Instagram, I'll tell you where I'm going to be, shows that I've been at. I try to post stuff that I train. So I'll give you guys behind the scenes stuff of what actually goes into, training and being a female professional wrestler. I'm trying to get a YouTube channel going to even go further behind the scenes. Like I just had a triple shot weekend, 2 weekends ago. Hopefully I got to edit that. I got to find time to edit that, put that up. But yeah, everything's Missa Kate 11. Follow me, follow my journey.
It's pretty good. Thank you so much for taking your time this weekend to come on to the podcast.
Oh, no, definitely. Thank you for having me. This was fun.
Oh, I thought it was fun as well. And everybody else, thank you for listening to Wrestle Popcast. And you can follow me at Twitter at WPopcast1, Facebook at Wrestle Popcast. And you can listen to my shows at Hitting the Marks Podcast Network, PodcastCity.net, Spotify, iHeartRadio, Apple Podcast. And you can follow me at YouTube at Wrestle Popcast as well, and on Instagram at Wrestle Popcast. Everybody have a great weekend.
What's up, Popcast listeners? This is Jargo from the Hitting the Marks Pro Wrestling Podcast, as well as HTM Sports, right here on the HTM Podcast Network. Listen, if you love Robin's show, then chances are you'll enjoy ours as well. We talk a lot of Ring of Honor, New Japan, MLW, AEW, NXT, WWE, you name it, we've got you covered. So hit that subscribe button. Be sure that you catch the Hitting the Marks Pro Wrestling Podcast, the weekly flagship, right here on the HTM Podcast Network.
Good evening, everybody. This is Robin Nelson with another edition of Wrestle Popcast. And my guest tonight is Jack Lord. He's a former pro wrestler, a promotion owner, and he was also inducted into the Alabama Pro Wrestling Hall of Fame. How's it going, Jack?
Doing good.
Man, you've been in the wrestling business for 40 years. That's an accomplishment.
Yeah, actually, I believe it's the 27th, the next month, will mark 44 years for me.
Wow, and you started in the business when you were 16.
Yep, sure did.
So, when did you fall in love with wrestling, and then also what influenced you to inspire you to train and become a pro wrestler at first?
Well, I was a fan for as far back as I can remember. One of my grandfathers was a Baptist preacher, and he took professional wrestling every bit as serious as he did his Bible. So we would go over on Saturdays to visit, and I would always sit in there and watch wrestling with him, and develop that love of the business. And then when I was 16, I started setting up rings and, you know, just being the ring boy and, you know, doing whatever, you know, they needed. I just wanted to be around it. I never really at that point thought about being an actual wrestler. I just thought I could contribute and be a part of that, you know, something that I love so much.
Hey, that's pretty good as well. So by doing that, you were actually paying your dues when you didn't even know it.
Oh, yeah.
So since your grandfather, you know, who was a preacher, you said, and was also a wrestling fan as well, do you have any memorable moments with your grandfather of watching wrestling, a certain match or anything like that?
Well, I remember, you know, watching, Leon Rossi was my hero. This was the Chattanooga territory and, the old Nick Gillis shows. And Lynn was the top babyface back then, and he was my hero. And I remember how vividly my grandfather loved him and how much he hated Tojo Yamamoto. And so anytime Tojo came on, he absolutely would just be booing, sitting in there in the living room. He was really into it. And it was great. You know, just a lot of great memories like that, just being with him.
That's pretty good. And when you decided to try to come become a pro wrestler, what did your grandfather think about you doing that?
Well, unfortunately, he passed away before I ever really started wrestling. After I got out of high school, I joined the Army. And even when I was in the Army, I would still go to shows. I would still help out. And I started training a little bit. My first duty station was Fort Benning, Georgia, Columbus, Georgia. And that was the hotbed for Georgia Championship Wrestling back in the day. And those were the first really big-time wrestlers I ever saw. And I remember the main event on that first show I went to was a cage match between Mr. Wrestling Number 2 and the Masked Superstar. And I knew when I saw that I no longer wanted to be on the sideline. That's what I wanted to do. So I still had several years commitment to the military. And, you know, I went ahead and served that time out and trained periodically, you know, throughout that time. And just 2 weeks after I got out of the Army in 1985, I started really training full-time and debuted just a couple of months after that.
So how was your debut for you? Did you have goosebumps, and what were you thinking in the ring?
Oh, man, I told everybody that I've ever told about this. If I had not been wearing a mask, my chin probably would have beat my forehead to death because my teeth were chattering. I was so nervous.
No, were you? Did your opponent know that you were really nervous since it was your very first match?
Yeah, he had actually helped me training off and on for a few years, and so we were already pretty good friends, and so he, you know, he guided me through that, and we had a huge crowd. There was like 800 people in that gym that night. You know, for an indie show, that's a pretty good crowd. So, you know, it was nerve-wracking, but I loved it. I mean, any doubt that I'd ever had before, after that, I knew I was where I was supposed to be.
That's pretty good as well. What were some of your favorite territories you liked to wrestle at back in the day when they had territories?
Well, I mostly worked the independents or outlaw shows back in those days. I did get to work a good bit continental, and that'll always be my favorite. Just so many good guys there, so many guys that took the time to, you know, help me to learn and get better. Guys like Danny Davis, you know, who went on and established Ohio Valley Wrestling and, you know, trained so many of the big names up in WWE. He was very instrumental in helping me. I was able to get hooked up right off the get-go with Louis Tillet. And Louis was one of those old school guys who his career was winding down, and he was doing some indies and still doing some continental stuff, and just really took me under his wing, you know, and really, really helped me a lot. So it was a great experience. Even working outlaw shows back then, I started off working 4 to 5 shows a week and kept that up for the first 9 years that I worked.
Wow, by doing that, boy, you must have learned a lot.
Yeah, I never considered myself great, but I was a good hand. You know, I could go in the ring with anybody and have a good match, and it was never about ego. That was one thing that I was so blessed learning from Louis was, you know, he got my head on right from the get-go. You know, it was never about winning or losing. It was about making money. And you know, he taught me how to do that. And, you know, to this day, Louis is still one of my favorite people.
Do you have any memorable moments with him?
He actually ran a show one time, and it was way back in the middle of nowhere. We had a good crowd, but a lot of the guys couldn't find the facility. And he had always drilled into me, be prepared for anything. You know, you may, you know, have different gimmicks in your bag. So, you know, if somebody needs you to work twice or something, you've got a whole different gimmick that you can put on. And I wound up working 4 times that night, 4 different gimmicks. And so, you know, he got his money's worth out of me that night. And to be honest, he paid me for every match I did. A lot of times promoters will do that. Hey, you want to work twice? You work twice, you're still going to get paid what you're going to get paid to begin with. But Louis always took care of it.
Hey, that's pretty good as well. When you were wrestling all those times as well, did you bust on the mask as well?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. For the first 2 years, I did a mask gimmick called the Lord Warrior, which the promoter I was working for first, because I was so big, he wanted to do almost like a ripoff Road Warrior type thing. So that was kind of his way. I would wear the spike stuff out to the ring, but I always wore a mask, you know, to go with it. Yeah, and that was fun. I mean, it was a good learning experience. But, you know, as soon as I come out from under the mask, I did. Now, with Continental, I did probably 8 different mask gimmicks, I guess. Ronnie West was the general manager there, and Ronnie took a liking to me from the get-go. And I always thought that there would be something for me, Jack Lord, you know, down the road. So he always, when he needed somebody to put somebody over, he would put me out there, but he'd always put a mask on me because he didn't want to hurt me. But, you know, that was a great experience. He always took care of me money-wise, too. So, you know, it was great. I miss those days.
I bet you do as well. So what finally decided you to get rid of the mask and just wrestle without one?
Well, I always intended to get rid of it. You know, I saw from the beginning that only a few guys ever had successful mask gimmicks. You know, and it was especially a lot in the Outlaws. You know, you'd have guys imitating those gimmicks. And the crowd wouldn't know. I mean, the guys would know in the locker room. Sometimes the crowd wouldn't know, but that always bothered me. I never really wanted to do somebody else's gimmick. And I knew if I didn't have the mask, then I couldn't, you know, I could establish my own character. I never tried to copy anybody else. You know, I never wanted to be a Fargo or, you know, because there was a ton of those guys back in the day. But, you know, just trying to be an individual.
So how did you reinvent yourself after you got rid of the mask? I know you were trying to be your own individual. What ideas did you have that finally got you to reinvent yourself in the ring?
Well, Ron had mentioned to me that he wanted to do some kind of like a Playboy type deal, which was kind of popular back in the day, you know, but, you know, to do my own stamp on it. And I had a guy I tagged with. Well, actually, I went to about 2 different, 3 different partners doing this, but we bleached our hair, and we went as the Heartbreakers. And, you know, had the tights with, you know, little hearts on them, and had boots with a big heart, broken heart on the side, and, you know, it was a pretty good gimmick, and we did get, you know, quite a bit of work back then. But that idea was Ronnie's to begin with. It wasn't mine, and eventually I evolved out of that and, you know, just kind of became more of what I felt comfortable with. You know, I was an Army veteran, and, you know, I don't think I'm the toughest guy in the world, but, you know, I could hang. So that's kind of more how my character eventually evolved. Once, when Continental shut down and I wasn't committed to doing that Heartbreaker thing anymore, I transitioned into developing that Bomber Jack Lord character more, and that's pretty much the character I stayed with for the rest of my career.
Hey, that's pretty awesome as well. And speaking of the Heartbreakers, how'd you become part of that tag team? And what was your chemistry with your partner? And did you guys have any, like, memorable matches together?
My first partner was a guy named David Jones. And David was tremendous. I mean, he was a power lifter in great shape. And, you know, we worked a lot of those outlaw shows around together as a tag team. And just worked a lot of those local babyface tag teams, and it was always good. Now, my other partner, Monty Rodriguez, Monty would remind you of Michael Hayes. Had the long blonde hair like Michael, and, you know, Bill, and he's about, I'm 6'4", he's about 6'6", so we were pretty good size boys, you know. But we traveled a lot. We did a lot of Tennessee stuff, Alabama, some Georgia, a little bit of Mississippi, but, you know, we just worked around with just whoever, you know, anybody wanted us to work with. I loved working with Mike Golden. Mike had a partner back then, Chance Myers, and I worked with those two in tag matches quite a bit. But we always had a great time.
Hey, that's pretty good as well. You also got in the ring with some great wrestlers as well. Let's talk about how you got in the ring with Terry Gordy and JYD, the Junkyard Dog. What was it like working with those guys in the ring?
Man, it was great. JYD was always so funny. He wouldn't do a whole lot because, you know, he didn't want to get hurt. I understand that because he still had the opportunity. Even when he came and worked at the indie level, you know, there was always a door somewhere that he was going to go through to get back on the big time. So, you know, he didn't want to do stupid stuff. So a lot of times he would get promoters to actually book me to come work him because he knew, you know, that I knew how to entertain the crowd and get heat on him without him having to take a bunch of bumps or, you know, do anything silly in the ring. And we just developed a friendship out of that, too. He was just a great guy. And Terry was kind of along the same lines. The difference was Terry and I, Terry could be a little tight in the ring at times. And I didn't mind that because I could be, too. So I wound up eventually is when Terry would be getting ready to go to Japan, which the style is a lot stiffer over there, he would get me booked on shows so that we could go out there and just basically beat each other up and so he could get him in that mindset again. And I didn't mind it. And he didn't mind getting hit in return. And then when he would come back, it would be the same thing. He would already have me booked for some shows where he could wind down. So, you know, he knew that he could depend on me because I knew what his mindset needed to be and, you know, how he needed to, you know, kind of calm everything down once he was back in the States. So it was, we just had a great relationship. You know, we traveled together quite a bit. I was never one of his, you know, party buddies. And eventually we became real close, especially near the end when he was really getting his life cleaned up and, you know, had quit partying and everything. And you know, we talked a good bit those last few months before he passed away. He was in a good place in his life, and I'm glad I could be a part of that.
So when you finally guys became friends and all that, do you have like a great story about you and Terry as well? And then when, you know, like Terry passed away, I mean, he's been gone for a while. How did you take it?
It was hard. It was really unexpected. I had worked with him maybe a couple of weeks before he passed away, and he, you know, he was great. He had lost a lot of weight. He was in shape. We had a great conversation that night behind the scenes, and in fact, he wrestled Jeff Van Kemp, who was doing the Lord Humongous gimmick. Jeff had come back up to Birmingham to do that for the promoter, and they had a great match, and, you know, a couple weeks later, just out of nowhere, you know, he was gone. And it was painful. I have to admit, I went to the viewing the night before, and Buddy Roberts, as sad as it was, the stories Buddy was telling about life on the road with him had everybody laughing, which was what Terry would have wanted. So, you know, that's a great memory to have with him.
That's pretty good as well, and you're like real well known in Alabama too. What was some of your favorite matches over in the Alabama territory since you were like wrestling in the Outlaws?
Well, after Continental shut down, I worked with Danny Davis a lot. Danny Davis and Kenny Wayne did the Nightmares, and me and my partner with the Heartbreaker thing worked with them for, I guess, almost 2 years after Continental had shut down. You know, they still stayed pretty much in the area. So I worked with Danny. Danny and I would always open the shows with a singles match. And then we would do a deal where my partner would hit the ring and his partner would make the save and we'd set up to do a tag match for the main event. And we would do this same thing in every town. And, of course, me and my partner would come in every town as the tag team champions and then drop the belts to them at the end of the show every time. It was, I loved working with him. Of course, like I say, JYD. I had some really good times with Austin Idol, too.
Oh, really? Do tell. What's some of your favorite stories with Austin Idol?
He just, Austin was one of those guys, too, who he didn't want to do a lot if he didn't know you and trust you. But once we kind of established that I wasn't going to do anything stupid, he really made me look great in there. He liked the fact that, just like JYD, that I could get heat with the crowd without having to make the baby face bump all the time. So, you know, that made an easier night for him, too. But I worked, you know, Bob Armstrong, all the boys. First steel cage match I ever had was against Brad. So, you know, just about anybody that was ever anybody in Alabama, I worked with one time or the other.
That's pretty good as well. You're also friends with Brian Scott and James Armstrong as well.
Yes.
So,
I thank the world of him.
Oh, so did you work with those guys as well?
Yeah, I don't think I was Brian's first match, but I was probably the second or third match he ever had. And I remember Bob coming in with him, and I've told Brian this story many times, so I'm not saying anything out of school. But Bob came in with him for the show one night, and he said, you know, we're in the back, and he said, "Hey, Jack, I want you to work with my boy Brian. He's just starting out." I said, "Okay." And so we went out, we had the match, and it was terrible. And I go back in the back, and I'm thinking, this is real, because he can't really be an Armstrong. But to his credit, he became one heck of a wrestler. And he's always been just so respectful and just such a nice guy. And every bit of success he's ever had, he's really earned it.
I bet he has. I wouldn't doubt it. I mean, he came from a family of wrestlers.
Yeah.
Hey, that's pretty...
Yeah, that's one thing about Bob is all his boys were so respectful and just so nice to be around. It was just always a pleasure, you know, to be in a locker room with them. Whether you got in the ring with them or not, just being in the locker room was great. All the jokes and, you know, just cutting up and having a good time in the back. It was great.
Oh, I bet it was as well. I remember we were talking a little bit too. We were talking about a young up and coming talent that's making a name for himself in the indies as well, and you wanted me to reach out to him is Paxton Callaway.
Yeah.
Oh, that
the promotion, I don't know him personally, but you know, I saw some video on him and the promoter that I was working with, he was real high on it, you know, and I saw a lot of potential for that kid. And as I understand, he's getting looked at by WWE, and that's awesome.
Yeah, he did. He went to WWE as well to work out and try out as well.
Yeah.
And that kid's just a beast. He's just so huge.
Yeah, hopefully they can find something for him up there. He seems like he's got it.
Who knows? Maybe he can come down and work for you as well.
Yeah, hopefully. Trying to get everything. We're rebranding and starting a whole new show. I've got another partner I'm fixing to start working with, and he used to work for TNA in the office, so you know he's got a lot more contacts even than I do. So we're trying to get some stuff hopefully started up here in a few months.
And it's pretty good. You started your own promotion first. You started off with Southern Legacy Wrestling. Tell me a little bit about Southern Legacy Wrestling. And I know you're starting up you know, another one with a new partner, and then let's go and also talk about Premier One Wrestling.
Yeah, Southern Legacy Wrestling was a show I had started. It was a small show a few years ago, and I got it going, and then I started having some health issues. This was after I retired, and after I retired, the reason I retired was I always had bad knees. I blew them out when I was in the Army, and I finally wound up eventually having both knees replaced, and I'd also gone through about colon cancer, which I don't recommend for anybody, but I'm cancer-free, so, you know, that's great. But anyway, I started having some health issues after I got the show going, and I just couldn't do it all by myself. So I shut it down, and I kind of stayed out of the business for the most part for a couple of years. You know, I still, you know, I would help guys get booked and keep in touch, but I didn't really go to shows or anything for a while. I just wasn't really able to. And then I had a couple of guys that I was friends with, and they wanted to start doing something, so we just revived the name and started running. We had a show on Fight TV for almost 2 years, and it was a, you know, pretty successful promotion down here. We just, ultimately, the three of us all had a different vision of where we wanted to go with the show, and so, you know, we parted on good terms, which I know is kind of rare in wrestling, but you know, I took the show, the name, and, you know, I went my way, and one guy, I don't even think he's involved with the business at all anymore, and the other guy started up a new promotion there where we had been running, and I believe he's doing pretty good.
Hey, that's pretty good as well. So you're looking forward to Premier One Wrestling as well. I hope it all works out for you.
Yeah. I can't really give a lot of details yet, but yeah, we've got quite a bit of things coming down the pike with it. Just not rushing it. Partner and I, neither one, we're not in a hurry. We want to make sure things lined up the way it needs to be before we, you know, open floodgates, more or less. So we've got him and another guy that I'm helping out that's trying to get a promotion going. We're going to be a part of the big show in Nashville on June the 1st. Gosh, and I can't remember the name of that promotion. They're doing the last show at the fairgrounds.
Okay.
The city's tearing down the fairgrounds here in the near future. And this is the last wrestling show that's going to be in the fairgrounds. So it's a big deal. Ricky and Robert's there. I can't remember who all else, but there's several, you know, big names that they've got on the card. And they're also having that day a tryout type deal where they've asked me to come and my partners and other promoters, you know, around to come and see. So guys come and try out, and we can, you know, take a look at potential new talent and, you know, get some names and numbers and see about booking some guys.
Hey, it's pretty good. I hope it works out for you.
Yeah, it's a great idea. I'm looking forward to it.
And you were also inducted into the Alabama Pro Wrestling Hall of Fame as well. How did that happen for you?
It kind of surprised me, actually. I was in the inaugural class. It's something that some guys here put together, and, you know, they wanted to honor the past, you know, and the impact that wrestling has had on the state of Alabama. And so I was, you know, asked to be inducted into that first class, and it was a great honor. Since then, we've had Bob Armstrong's been inducted, several others, Jerry Stubbs, Arn Anderson is going in this year. So, you know, to be inducted into something, you know, of that magnitude is very humbling, you know, and I'm very appreciative for that honor.
Also, when you're not in the ring as well, you are a huge Frazetta fantasy artist fan as well, especially Conan.
Yeah, grew up, you know, reading those books. I was not much of a reader when I was a kid. And about the only thing I would read was comic books. And then one day I was at a store looking for some comic books, and I noticed some books over to the side, and one of them was an Edgar Rice Burroughs paperback with a Frank cover called A Princess of Mars. And I had no interest in reading that. The cover caught me. So I picked it up, and I read it, and then it was, my mother used to get mad at me because she couldn't go to the store without me wanting to, you know, some kind of new book. And it just, I've always since then been just a ferocious reader, especially of science fiction. And, you know, Frank, if it hadn't been for his artwork, I'd never have cracked that book.
That's pretty.
I've always been a fan of his.
So what got you to become, since his artwork as well, you know, picking up science fiction novels as well, so what got you interested in Conan the Barbarian?
Well, it was just, you know, part of that, once that door was open for reading, I started wanting to read everything. You know, I would buy the Doc Savage reprint novels, and The Avenger, and The Shadow, and Fu Manchu, and Conan the Barbarian, and Carl the Conqueror, and, you know, whatever was out there. I was pretty much, you know, whatever I could make. I grew up on a farm, so, you know, I'd get a pretty good allowance, and I'd spend everything that I had, plus whatever else I could, you know, get from my parents and my grandparents, and I'd go buy books.
I bet you probably had a huge library.
I did, and I still do. I have quite a collection still, and I gave all of those to my youngest daughter, who is 9, and she has started really getting into that kind of stuff, too. So I went ahead and passed those on to her.
Hey, that's a good thing to do as well. What's some of your favorite stuff in the world of science fiction since you fell into it?
I used to read, now I don't read as much science fiction anymore. I've kind of matured into like mysteries and stuff now, but Robert A. Heinlein was a favorite of mine back in the day. Isaac Asimov. I like stuff that, quite frankly, that I didn't understand because it made me think. And a lot of those guys were way smarter than I was, and that helped me want to develop myself intellectually a little bit more.
So some of those books you also read over the years as well, did it also help you with your like your psychology, more of your character in the ring?
It did, and I didn't realize that for a while. I had great teachers with Bob Armstrong, who really took time with me at Continental and let me sit with him and see how he would put stuff together and how he would run the TVs. And because I knew that I had bad knees going in, so I knew that I would not have a forever career, but I always wanted to be involved with wrestling, so I needed to find something other than being in the ring to be able to keep me a part of it. So over time, I got, you know, I'm pretty good at storytelling. And for the longest, I was thinking, well, I'm just, you know, I'm doing what I was taught. And then I got to realizing, well, I may be doing what I was taught, but I'm also putting it together the way stories were put together in those books. You know, the adversary, you know, always has to come out ahead for the longest until the good guy finally comes over, you know, wins in the end. And that's basically every book, you know, was like that back then. So it was, you know, it was teaching me without me realizing it for a while.
And that's pretty good that's brought you in as well. And also, like, the different gimmicks you had as well in the ring. Did you ever thought about having something science fiction as well at one time?
No. The Bomberjack Lord character is me. You know, it's just me with the volume turned up. But I've always told guys that So there's some wrestlers that can take characters that are absolutely nothing like themselves and, you know, make it hugely successful. But for the majority of us, we got to be who we are. We just have to turn that volume up. And there's probably no better example of that than Steve Austin. You know, once he was allowed to be himself amped up, you know, he was great. And there's a lot of similarities in the way his character was and the way mine was. I was there first, so I didn't rip him off. but I never really thought about doing, a character too far out there. I wanted a character that people could believe in. And I had a pretty long career, and I think, that decision worked for me.
Did you ever have any regrets in your career?
Well, yeah. I don't say regrets. I had opportunities that, Terry Gordy tried to get me on the thing for Japan one time, and, I had situations at home that was just not going to allow me to do that. And I passed that out. I wish that I hadn't. But going back, there wasn't any way to change that. So I don't know if I would regret it. I wish things would have been different. And I had, some other opportunities for the same reason, a lot of home life stuff that I had to stay there and take care of. And so I couldn't really be that far out on the road. But I'm pretty well pleased with the career I had. I was active for 24 years. And my knee doctor told me at 30 that I would be in a wheelchair by the time I was 35. And I wrestled until I was 50 years old.
Wow, I bet you probably give some of those young guys in the ring the run for their money as well for all the times you've been in the ring.
Well, I worked a very basic style, a lot of mat stuff, and I could never high fly. I was nowhere near the athlete guys are today, but I was believable in what I did. I knew what I could do, and what I could do, I did well. And it wasn't about my ego either. I knew I was there to work with whoever was in there, and I wanted to make them look good as well as make myself look good. So, I had a good reputation, and I worked a lot right up until I finally did retire. I stayed pretty busy.
So when you finally decided to retire from the ring and hang up your boots, was it pretty hard for you?
Yeah, it was hard. It's been 10 years, and I miss it every day. I do. But on the other hand, I will say that, booking shows and promoting, helping develop guys, it gives me more satisfaction than anything I ever did in the ring. I do miss performing, but I'm still a part of the business, and that's all I ever really wanted.
That's pretty good. So what you're saying is you enjoy, to mold these young wrestlers' minds and stuff, to get them prepared for the world of professional wrestling.
Yeah, my big thing, a lot of guys don't understand. I preach the basics. I don't like guys when they work for me doing a lot of these big, wild high spots and stuff. Now, there's nothing wrong with that. I think that you need to learn it and all, but I think you need to learn those basics first. And that's what I push with everybody. That's what WWE looks at when they're hiring people. How good are you, basically? Because they can teach you all that other stuff. They'll mold you to their style, and just like anywhere else will, too. But I want to make sure that you know how to take care of yourself in the ring and be safe and not get hurt and not hurt anybody else.
So when you teach them the basics as well, is that also counting as well as in-ring psychology as well?
Yes. Yeah, that's a big part of it. My frequent thing after a match is when a guy comes up to me and says, "How was the match?" I'll say, "Okay, tell me what it means. What did it mean out there?" And most of the time, they're lost because they can't tell me what it meant. They can't tell me the story they were telling because they weren't telling one. They were just out there doing things, you know. And once they understand that, you know, and that light clicks, it's probably one of the most rewarding moments that I ever get is when, you know, guys understand what I'm asking them to do. I had a guy here, the big guy, and to be as big as he's like 360, but he's in great shape, and he can do anything any luchador can do, just all kinds of top rope stuff. And I wouldn't let him do it. I made him stop, and I made him work a basic mat style, big man brawler style for a long time. And about 6 months later, and he was disgruntled. I know he was. He still worked. He didn't argue. And then one night he came in and I said, okay, I want you to do that big backflip deal off the top rope. And I said, you'll miss and the guy takes advantage of you and beats you. So he said, oh, okay. So he goes out, he does the move, and the crowd erupts. When he does that, they go crazy. And he walks in the back and walked up to me and kind of lowered his head for a minute. He looked up at me and he said, okay, now I understand.
That's pretty good because I like to go to a lot of shows. Like you said, there's nothing wrong with the high risk or high flying moves. I mean, I like some of that as well. But sometimes I like to go to some promotions when they just do old school style wrestling where it's all technical and stuff. And I've been at some shows where, you know, fans are like getting real bored because they don't want to see a technical match. But, you know, I think that sometimes it's great to see some old fashioned technical wrestling.
Yeah, I think it's all important. You know, the product has changed. You know, it's not the way it was when I was growing up. It's not the way it was when I started. You know, I wished it was. But if what we did 30 years ago, 40 years ago, if it was still drawing money, then that's what we'd still be doing. You know, and I know a lot of old school guys, you know, they get bitter about it because the business has changed. You know, I was that way for a while, too. But everything in this world changes. It adapts. And it moves in a slightly different direction. You know, whether it's, you know, they don't make cars the way they used to.
Oh, yeah.
They don't have the same style. They don't make them the same way. And everything is like that. But especially our business. You know, it's different now. You got to do something bigger and more spectacular to draw people's attention because there's so many other alternatives out there for your entertainment dollar. You got to do something that fans are going to say, oh, okay, I'm still going to watch this. I'm still going to buy the network, or I'm still going to pay for that pay-per-view, or I'm going to go buy that ticket. You know, and if you're just going out there and doing the same stuff that was done 40 years ago, they're not going to do that.
Oh, I totally agree with you as well. What do you think about indie wrestling today? It's been really popular lately, and the cool thing about it today is there's more opportunity for anyone in the wrestling business to go get what they want.
Yeah, I'm excited. Anytime that there's more opportunities for the men and women in this business to go out and make a living, I'm for that. You know, I'm not particularly a fan of some of the promotions that do a lot of the more adult stuff, the comedy stuff. You know, that's not my thing. But if there's an audience for it, then do it. You know, it's like hardcore wrestling. You know, I know a lot of these guys that do the death matches, you know, and I love them. They're great guys. They're good friends. I don't like to watch what they do, but there's an audience for it. You know, and as long as there's an audience, as long as people are paying to see that, then you know, there's no reason to stop it. And the more stuff that's going on, the more opportunities are out there. And I love seeing this generation getting opportunities that they are.
Oh, I totally think so as well. Especially women's wrestling, too. They're getting a huge boost up as well.
Yeah.
Because there's some tough women out there, man, that can, you know, take some hits and bumps and put on a good match as well as any other, like, a male wrestler.
Yeah, the girls, of course, I always had the standards of Bambi, Selena Majors, and Peggy Lee Leather. And I worked so many shows with them, and they're two of my best friends. But it was hard to follow them on any show because they could go harder, longer, and better than just about any guy on the show. So when I see the girls now, I see that same mentality that they had back then. You know, they were struggling and trying to make a name for themselves, which they did. And now these girls are getting more opportunities on a bigger scale. In fact, Selena, you know, is one of the, I think she's the trainer at WOW now and has a lot to do behind the scenes and stuff. So, you know, those girls that you're seeing there now are a product of her teaching them how to get better.
That's pretty good. Hey, I totally agree with you on that as well. What does pro wrestling mean to you? And if there's anything you could change about it, what would you change and why?
Well, you know, I don't know that I would change anything. You know, it's easy to sit back and quarterback from my chair.
Oh, there's a lot of them out there.
I've complained a little recently about the direction WWE's going. I don't think the writers are putting out their best efforts. Or maybe then again, ultimately it's not the writers. It's Vince who's making the wrong decisions. And, you know, I hope that the upcoming competition with all these other promotions that are up and coming is going to make them up their game. Because even though I've been in this business for as long as I have, I'm still a fan. I still enjoy. I'm sitting here with SmackDown on right now while we're talking.
Oh, I know. So am I.
Yeah. You know, I love our industry. I love our business. And, you know, I just wish people would put out their best effort. And I don't think WWE is doing that quite right now. And like I say, that really lies at Vince's feet. And I'm not saying, you know, it's time for him to go to pasture because they're the best in the world. And they're going to be the best in the world for a long time to come. You know, it's going to take a lot of years for somebody to get to that level. So they're not going anywhere. I just hope they'll improve, you know, storyline-wise a little bit more and use their talent a little bit smarter. But, you know, that's my opinion.
So what are your thoughts?
There's so many great choices coming up out there. You know, the stuff Cody Rhodes is doing, I'm excited about. I know it's going to be more of an adult-oriented type thing, which is fine if, you know, that's the audience they're trying to draw. I hope they're all successful. I hope everybody becomes millionaires.
That's pretty good as well. So what's your thoughts on Vince thinking about how indie wrestling's getting more popular? Because for a while, it was just only him, and he was, you know, he's still the big dog in the yard as well still. So what do you think he's thinking about all these, like, promotions like, you know, MLW, AEW, you know, New Japan, Ring of Honor, Ring Warriors, all the, you know, top scale indie promotions that are, like, really popular today?
Well, I mean, I read years ago, and, you know, I didn't hear him say this, but I read several accounts of where he saw where when the territories died, that it hurt him because there was no talent pool to choose from anymore.
Yeah.
And I've talked to a lot of the old-time guys, and they were talking about how, you know, indie wrestling kept professional wrestling alive for years.
Yeah.
And so now I believe that it's to his advantage, ultimately, really, for all of these promotions to be running. Because, you know, the thing about wrestling is change. You cannot keep the same people all the time.
Oh, no, you can't, no.
So once those people are, you know, they get out there, they get a name, you know, and then it's time for them to move on, And that's an opportunity for Vince to come in and say, okay, come here and let me do something with you. And the same thing for them. You know, when Vince, you know, gets rid of people or, you know, a lot of times he misses the boat on a lot of people. And but I know it's a big boat that he's over. So, you know, I understand, you know, where he misses some of his talent sometimes. But those folks have an opportunity to go somewhere else and rebuild and, you know, still have opportunities to make a living. As used to, you know, for a long time, once you left WWE, it was hard. It was hard to make a living. So, you know, now that's not as hard as it was. And I'm tickled about that.
I totally agree with you as well. So where can everybody find you on social media and find out details on Premier One Wrestling when you're ready to tell all the great stuff?
Well, you can find me on, you know, Facebook under just Jack Lord. You'll see the smiling, bald-headed guy. And now I've still got the Southern Legacy Wrestling page up. We're transitioning it over to the POW page, but you can find us there, and you know, that's where we'll be doing all our updates. I'm working on a new website, but it's not up yet, so I can't plug what's not there yet. But you know, it's P1 Wrestling on I think Twitter and Instagram also. So,
all right, thank you so much for coming on. Out of your schedule and sharing your story and everything.
Hey, no problem, man. I've enjoyed it.
Oh, I know. It was great. I enjoyed talking to you as well. And everybody, you can also follow me at Wrestle Popcast on Spotify, iHeartRadio, Apple Podcasts. You can follow me at Twitter at WPopcast1. You can follow me at Facebook at Wrestle Popcast. And you can follow me at Hitting the Marks Podcast Network and also at Podcast City at podcastcity.net. Everybody have a great evening.